10-15 years. There's a, in social media, there's a lot of talk going on. This I cannot but comment. The armed forces talk about their duty. Very interesting. You will have these things which are passing around, people saying that we do have rights. We are also being killed. I don't understand. I mean, I thought they had only duty. What right do they have? Do they have a choice to tell the executive that we will not do? We will not do what we are being asked to do. If they don't have the choice, then it gets converted to duty. So, I mean, this is absurd. The society is talking, the army officers are talking, they are saying, you know, we also have rights, we also are entitled. We are part of state in India. Let us be very clear about it. Another discussion which goes into a dimension is on the violence factor of it. The fact of the matter is that people have rights to protest, struggle, ask for change. If the state feels it is within the paradigm, it can allow, it can pass laws, it can give facilities, it can set up infrastructure, it can do everything to ameliorate the problem people are agitating against in one form or the other. It can respond in a fairly democratic way, in a conducive way, in a benign way. People in response to that also respond equally till the matter is resolved. That is how any kind of, so this discussion on rights very often gets derailed by people who wish to say that, you see, you have the right, but you know you've turned violent and therefore that is undemocratic. The question is that the right is being asked in a context, the state categorizes that right and responds to it in a particular way. The moment it responds in a particular way, those who are struggling are found to respond in a similar way to be able to hold on to the right and struggle to say that we demand this, we have a right. So this point, I think, is another dimension which we need to understand and to be fairly clear in our perspective, that rights per se, the reason for something happening in a particular form is because there is a response from authorities, from governance or the state, which characterizes it in a particular way and responds in a particular form. People therefore respond equally to that because they are still wanting a resolution to that problem. I want to touch two other issues. Triple talaq and polygamy. Nehru, 1945. I am convinced that the future government of free India must be secular in the sense that government will not associate directly with any religious faith but will give freedom to all religious functions. Somewhere in between, 27 years later, the preamble, which was Sovereign Democratic Republic, gets changed to Sovereign Socialist Secular Democratic Republic. Tough question, how to be secular by state, which is compromised by two key contradictions which operate in the society, one having a precept, one having a practice, totally divided. How it can juggle between the two and find a resolution in a secular form is an extremely interesting question which we all face today. Keeping to Nehru's statement in reference and the revision in the preamble, secularism got to be defined in added dimensions with the government civil codifying many aspects of Hindu law. So 1945 Nehru, and then civil codification, many aspects of Hindu law gets civil codified. So whether it be from the marriage act, Hindus could have multiple wives, Badi Rani, Choti Rani, Ex Rani, Vai Rani, and every other aspects of it in 56. Child labor, sati, untouchability, these all get civil codified very interestingly. No other religion is addressed. To take Sir's problem point, he says there is this entire Hindu fascist. You see, a state which is residing on two contradictions, does cannot reconcile this contradiction, one side capital labor in a monopolistic moribund form, and a decadent social practice, which in practice does not allow you to have codified civil law to intervene in the social sanction practice, then there is a role of the dominant religion which plays. That dominant religion automatically comes into play and takes over. The fact that the state cannot, does not, I use the word cannot in hindsight, does not address any other religion, codifies certain aspects of Hindu religion and proceeds. And then today, files an appeal in the Supreme Court on triple talaq and polygamy of a particular community. It says, even though, this is center submission, it is, even though it may be true to say that only some women are directly and actually affected by triple talaq and polygamy, the fact remains that every woman who is subject to the said law lives under threat, fear or prospect of these practices being invoked against her, which in turn impacts her status, her choices, her conduct and her right to life with dignity. Absolutely a beautiful, wonderful statement. Genuinely right. A very clear civil code oriented argument. However, this is fanned communal passion. The minority community says it is a witch hunt. Another dimension of this particular community says that it does not concern in our personal law, it does not operate. So there is distancing taking place, there is confusion taking place, there is communal passion being fanned. And civil codified law must not infringe on religious laws in a secular state. Now this is interesting. You cannot infringe in this law in a secular state, you have declared it so. And so the Indian state in this confusion just does not know how to operate, how to hold this factor. In particular, in fact, the question really arises that if the state is the government is raising these issues, possibly it also needs to raise the fact that a Hindu can get married a second time subject to the first wife not objecting to that marriage. Now why this doesn't get codified? Because effectively it is polygamy. So we have these contradictions which we are facing, and this issue is being taken up, and this obviously fans the majority Hindu feelings that codify, codify. Now I raise another dimension. If you have to codify, then you codify also the fact that the religious stratification, Hindu religion based stratification of the caste system should be made illegal. Because these are aligned to social practices in the society, civil code cannot tolerate social practices which are against the realm of gender, caste, religion, class differentiation and difference. It cannot allow it. So then you should also say, the state should also say, that Hindu religious formulations of caste system is illegal. Define it so. Then you define the whole question a reservation on economic grounds, on grounds of actual being deprived on economic conditions. It becomes economic from extra-economic, but this does not operate. So this confusion and understanding really comes only from a perspective when you introduce the element of political economy and understand the class character, the state, the formulation of the Indian state and how it operates in duality, in dichotomy. I want to touch upon another one. We have some more time, a little bit more. Meat eating, cow slaughter. You see, survival, eating habits, nutrition, even delicacy, these are the dimensions, availability, which determine the factor of eating any meat. Whether it is duck, whether it is monkey meat, whether it is dog meat, whether it is cow meat, buffalo meat, chicken, whatever you want to define, fish. These are the four or five things we define. There are also cultural practices which are engaged. Now, a state which says we are modern, we are advanced, we understand, does not know how to handle the demands of one community which makes it extra economic, saying my religion says cow In fact, one the High Court judge said it should be declared a national animal. More he said, we just don't want to do it. The other religion says that eating pork is against our religion, it's a dirty animal. They too have a right. There is another religion which says we will eat everything. Now, what does the state do under these conditions? Can it take extra economic factors and declare that you cannot slaughter? This is the Hinduization of the dominant religion which takes place of a state which is confused to handle two contradictions, multiple contradictions, and which has a formalized civil codified law. You know, I mean, one can actually say with the same logic, if you say that the Indian state is ordered and advanced, then I can see, you know, communities, large Hindu communities in UK demanding the same in UK also, you know, our sentiments are hurt, please stop cow slaughter. State are equally modern, no? Both ways. So either acknowledge that this state in India has a problem and therefore go into defining the issues contained therein. And if you say that we are a modern state, we are a progressive state, we are part of the international community, then please imagine that there are Hindus in UK can also say cow slaughter banning, and UK state must pay some attention to that. And that's the absurdity level to which these things operate in our country. And it's important to understand the socio-economic context within which these are operating. In fact, in America, you can lampoon the president, do anything you want. He has the right to counter-sue you. In India, social hierarchy tells you that president or the prime minister or any big is a person you cannot talk ill about. You will get criminal charges against you. This is not how civil coded life works. This is now how a modern society works. But in India, it so works. I don't want to go further. There are four or five other examples of bonded labor. The fact that bonded labor exists, we all know. In fact, the truth is that if bonded labor were to be asked, they give you freedom. You go. You don't have to be bonded. It will surprise a lot of us, and many of us understand. The person says, please let me be where I am. I'm surviving. It's the same story as in feudal UK, in England or in France, that they preferred to stay within that because they had no other choice. It's the same situation for bonded labor, that they have no other choice. What they have as a choice is to fall into the hand of some labor contractor, work in some brick kiln, do not have the safety net of the landed relations where they are taken care of, and become a destitute. So bondedness at one side and codified law on the other side. In fact, this is a gross violation of democratic rights for the simple reason that the person, if the person protests and organizes himself, then that is a democratic fight that he is undertaking to change the essential property relation which is feudal in character. Some other examples I take here, and there is a booklet which you all have, which you all can read subsequently. The real issue which I just want to make in this bondedness, nobody wants to address this, is not a factor of codified law and social practice. What is it that will release that person from bondedness? It is not the civil codified law against social sanction of practice. It is one thing. The right of that person, the tiller, to own the land, that is what gives that person freedom and a choice to be free from bondedness. The entire concept of land to the tiller, which is treating it not as social relations, land as social relations, but land as an economic factor, this is what in fact differentiates and says you can address it in the Indian context of giving land to the bonded and freeing him because he gets an alternative. These are fine distinctions which only the construct of state, civil society, political economy, class perspective can give you in interpreting law rather than debating why civil codified law cannot tackle bondedness whereas the practice continues. I had examples of development and displacement, of compensation, of reintegration, which I will not go into. I had an example of skilling and employability, which is a huge hubbub which is going on. Here I just want to make a thing that 30 crores people are targeted to be skilled by 2020. 47 million people will be provided by Modi and his coterie to work abroad. Wonderful. Basically 30 crores people being trained means that there has to be something, some force which can absorb them. You don't create skilling if there's no need for it. So let me be very progressive. Therefore, Make in India and this entire thing means that there's going to be expanded capital-labor relationship which is going to get established. Huge manufacturing bases will be created wherein all these vocations, there are over 100 vocations which are being targeted by the National Skill Development Council and by the government. And these 30 crore people by 2020, let's believe 30 crore will be 300 million people, they will all get an opportunity because the socio-economy of India will characteristically change. I don't know, in all these years, no characteristic change could come. Where that demand is going to arise from and how these people will get absorbed, believing that they are trained beautifully, that the industry are just waiting to lap them up. Where is the industry, one doesn't know, given the fact that there are islands and pockets of industrial growth in a typical semi-colonial scenario. But there is another dimension which is there. Is it that these people are given the right that after you are trained, like you are educated, now you find a job. You take, and if the market has the opportunity, you get a job. Do these people, the vocation, mind you, as an aside, ITI was a major initiative in the same thing which imploded. Why it imploded, nobody wants to address. Let's say the skill India is going to generate people and they are going to be absorbed. Are they going to be left to the market forces that, okay, now you have been trained, we have done our bit, your liberty has been supported, your civil rights has been supported, now you go get yourself a job. The fact that he may or may not get a job, given the fact that there is no expanded form of the production, relation to production, is a different story. But there's another story, that if they want to do some micro enterprise on their own, suppose they want to create little businesses around these vocations. There are health workers, there are physical fitness workers, there are lathe operators, there are diagnostic technicians, there are a huge number of these things. And I personally have been involved in this and in knowing. Will they? Like that worker who says, I need the right to know the production processes, the technology, the know-how, the managerial techniques, but cannot access the ability, the resources. Will these 30 crore people face the same situation that if we want to develop individually ourselves, build some micro enterprise, develop the human progress and economy in small ways, will they get access to the resources necessary to realize the dreams post the education is a dimension which the society doesn't answer. So skilling and Skill India, employment is not addressed, employability is addressed, and it's a very complex structure of 10,000 rupees per person, how it is shared. It's a very fascinating sharing. The trainer will get this, the assessment agency will get this, the individual will get this. It is subsidizing people. It is happening. But where it is leading to, these are the areas of concern, these are the dimensions I wanted to share in the context of democratic rights, civil liberties and human rights, the right to live. In the last instance, I just want to say that if you want to touch on 40% living below the poverty line, are there forces in the society which is looking at this huge tragedy of having two dimensions of societies, an old decadent system working, people living below the poverty line, to look at perhaps at an alternative developmental model? After all, you have to look at what the society needs for itself as a part of its democratic right, as we have said, that to be able to change the core issue of property relations as they exist by an alternative framework, an alternative developmental model, two people have the right to experiment, practice and work towards it. What is the response by the state towards categorizing this effort and therefore its response and form of response to ameliorate this problem is one huge dimension of democratic rights which we have to pose as intellectuals, as progressive people, as human beings with the right to life. I just want to end with Professor Haris Rao, and that he has enthused us. It's two small paragraphs, allow me to read. Professor Rao is a Marxist intellectual. He begins from 1848. His methodology of inquiry is dialectical historical materialism. For him, any analysis bereft of contextualizing issues within political economy is anathema to scientific inquiry and progressive thinking. Please speak on this side. The fulcrum of change, in this he locates the two opposing perspectives on rights, that of idealist and materialist approaches. The fulcrum of change, he states, lies at the base structure of society identified as the existing property relations. What are the property relations? There are two huge domains in India which are existing, one moribund, one decadent, neither having any solutions. Property relations act as impediment to change and development. Is the core democratic right of people to challenge this, because they were not born into it out of choice, therefore they have the freedom to exercise that human right to change, and therefore transforming these become the foundation of democratic rights. People need to exercise their democratic rights as the path to realizing the fundamental right to life, which is their human right. Professor Rao has a curious mind. He always investigates simultaneously as an existence of contradictory dimensions: boundedness and the right to vote, women's right, child marriage and dowry deaths, green farming belts coexisting by the side of dry, arid stretches. These are the first things that we learned way back in 72. Go down the Hadapsar Road, on the left side is green belt, on the right side is right. Can you understand what is imperialism and feudalism? Can you understand the conflict? There we were struggling with it. We continue to struggle, but I think a better understanding from the perspective of rights has emerged in our favor as our democratic rights today. Large farm holdings, wage labor and tenancy farming, people's technologies versus highly concentrated technology based on foreign investments, rights versus duties, state violence and democratic principles, status quo and people's democratic movements, the list is unending. In all this, what Professor Rao really posits for us to think and act upon is how the coexistence of multiple and mutually contradictory property relations being ineffectually managed by the Indian state, somehow managing these two, creates the grounds for people to exercise their choice to restructure society within a new democratic framework. The old cannot be recreated anymore. The conditions have changed, the two principal contradictions are a confused amalgamation, such that the social experience, I think this ending is beautiful, such that the social experience gained by them individually, you know, you own rights. When you go through the bourgeois democratic process, through the process of struggle, you become an owner of the rights and its practice. Such that the social experience gained by individuals and individually and collectively in the process of the struggle is fundamental, crucial, essential, absolutely the fulcrum of any realization, of any understanding. This makes them the true owners of the new society, politically, intellectually and ideologically. Thank you very much for the time.